Ashley Wuhagno with the City of San Antonio Department of Arts and Culture. And on behalf of our department, I want to welcome you to our Culture Commons Gallery for this panel discussion being led by Sarah Castillo with the artist, a Lady Bates Gallery, who curated a portion of this exhibit. And Sarah and her team here, and she'll introduce them, have done a wonderful job with the exhibit. I want to welcome you here to the space. I want to thank Sarah and recognize her, as well as all the artists who did a great job putting the show together. So thank you for joining us, and hopefully you enjoy the lunch. With that, Sarah.
Thank you so much, everyone, for being here today. Can you hear me okay? All right. I really want to give a huge shout out to Henry Ford Academy, Our Lady of the Lake University, and Southwest School of Art. You all are here today, right? Yes. We've been waiting for y'all. So again, thank you so much for being here. My name is Sarah, and I am a curator and owner of Lady Bates Gallery. I had the wonderful opportunity to curate a portion of this show here that you see. The title of the exhibition is United We Are One, and what I ended up doing is I worked to select five artists to present their work that started in January, and today is the closing. The artists we have here are Julia Barbosa Landois, Anel Flores, Susy González, Antonia Padilla, and Kim Bishop. So for the majority of our talk, I'm going to allow the artists to speak. We'll have a group of questions. Each one will have some time to answer, and then we'll have some time for questions. And so we're here today and are sharing our experiences as women in the arts. I myself I'm an artist as well. So what we wanted to ask you all is, can anyone name a very famous artist, woman artist, here in San Antonio? Underrepresentation of women in the art world, and particularly your experiences as being artists here in San Antonio. We did a little bit of research. We reached out to San Antonio Museum of Art, the McNay, trying to find out how many women are on their artist rosters, and I wasn't able to get that much information, but only did get a list from San Antonio Museum of Art. 23% of the artists that are on their rosters are women, and only 3 are Latina. With that said, we want to move forward and discuss what this means for us as artists now and in the future, and especially for you artists who are just starting and finding your way through the art world. First of all, I'm going to go ahead and I want all the artists to introduce themselves, their name, and give a little bit more information like that. So.
So my name is Julia Barbosa Landois, and I'm a native of San Antonio. I got a Bachelor of Fine Arts from UTSA, and then I moved away and got a Master of Fine Arts in Sculpture and Media from the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia. I guess I would say I've been a professional artist for about 10 years, which is when I graduated from graduate school, although I have made art since I was a child. And I work in a variety of media, performance, video, and installation, and also works on paper, which is what I have in the show here, I made the silk, the red, white, and blue silk screen print.
Okay. Hi, I'm Anel Flores, and thank you all for being here. I want to do like a tiny little special shout out to the Board Academy because I used to work there, I used to teach there, and I love all students and all the teachers. So thank you for being here. But ultimately, I've been an artist for about 20 years, professional artist. I am a storyteller originally, and recognized early that my story, I didn't know my story, I wasn't shown my story as a queer woman, I didn't find it anywhere, and so I just went on the track of telling the story as much as I could as a young queer woman, 18, 19, 20, and started as a writer and visual artist and continued to mend both worlds as a writer and visual artist. My goal as an artist is to try to, you know, help others tell their story, give other people an opportunity to tell their story through their art or just through their work in general. I'm very happy to be here today, especially among Deborah and all these amazing artists that are here at Sala and the group. So thank you for being here and
my name is Susy González. I'm from Austin. I'm born in Austin, grew up in Houston. I'm living here in San Antonio. I got my BFA at Texas State and my Master of Fine Arts at the Rhode Island School of Design, 2015. I think, you know, I've been an artist since I was, you know, born, but I think a lot of us kind of lose those ties. I guess I thought it was a hobby. Didn't think it could be a profession until like college. But I guess I've been serious about it, being like a career for about 8 years now. And I work in a variety of media. I studied painting, but I've been getting really into sculpture, maybe more installation work, video work, so kind of all over the place, kind of doing what I think is appropriate for like a particular concept.
Hi everybody, my name is Antonia Padilla. I'm a San Antonio native. I'm a child of the 60s. I went to high school, junior high in the 70s. My academic achievements are minimal at best. Went to SAC, never finished my degree. I was a quote unquote journalism major. I was very lucky to have had parents and grandparents that were always reading to me, And my language, my primary language is a visual language. I see pictures, I see moments in time, and I'm so lucky that I'm able to use a camera to basically record those moments for any reason that that you know you could want. I was a news photographer at the Pittsburgh Herald. That's a paper on the U.S.-Mexico border from 1985 to 2000. It was a daily paper. And when I left SAC for the third time, where I was a photographer at the Ranger, yay! I teachers are so important in everybody's life. And you can learn so much. And if you have people that care about you, you can sit up here.
Hi everybody, welcome. My name is Kim Bishop. I have been in the public school art classroom for the past 29 years, and I have 46 days left. I've been an artist all my life. I was very fortunate to be raised by my mom right across the street from the University of Texas in the 60s and 70s, and was allowed to explore my artwork then. I got my BFA from Southwest Texas State University, and I got my Master of Arts from Texas State. And I've been in San Antonio for 12 years, and I have two beautiful sons.
Okay, thank you so much, everyone. It's always a pleasure to learn about artists here in our community. Something I'm really curious about is, I want to know, why do you make art? And along with that, if you can also include in that answer, because when you're making art, it's about also your life and what that looks like. So if you could, you talk a little bit about why you make your art, and within that, describe your career, your day job, your night job, your side jobs. How have you experienced unfair practices as an artist? Talk about underrepresentation. Have you ever been ignored? Issues with sexism, censorship, access, etc. And anyone who's ready can begin.
Okay. Why do I make art? It's because I have to. There was a time in my life when there wasn't time. And I was raising my children, I was, you know, teaching, and I wasn't making art that I needed to make. And I really, it felt like I was starving. And so there came a point where I had to make a change. And that change was to make time for my art and for my career. And luckily, my family, my mom and my kids, they understood that and they were supportive of that. But it is a struggle because you have to be able to balance two lives, three lives, mom, teacher, artist. And it is a struggle. But it's a struggle that if I didn't do it, I don't think I could survive. That it's just, it's too much a part of me. I have to let it out.
Did you want to talk a little bit about your career path in that case?
Well, when I got my BFA, I got my BFA in commercial art, which I don't think is even around anymore. And I started working in that career, but as a woman, it was really hard because when I did start having children, I realized that I couldn't be a mom and do that at the same time. It was too many hours. So that's when I went into teaching, which is really the best thing I could have done. I've learned more from my students than I think my students have learned from me. I went into teaching after that, and now I'm retired. I started teaching in 1988, and now I have the opportunity, that teaching career has given me now the opportunity to, now at this age, at 55, to really focus on nothing but my studio. I've got my studio all set up.
Yes.
Ready to go.
Thanks, Kim.
Part of what made me create art, or why I decided, or you know, the things that drove me to create art, were just moments in my life. My parents were both from Igbo and came to the U.S. during the time where language, speaking Spanish, was punishable. So they were punished for every word. I mean, my mother's school in Mission, Texas, they had to pay a nickel for every word that came out of their mouth, but they only spoke Spanish, so that silences the story, right? My father was told in his school, just in another little town in South Texas, that he had to kneel on bottle caps or rice every time he spoke Spanish, and he still has scars on his knees. So those moments, when I learned those stories, I didn't know those stories until about the 80s. Before the 80s, we were an English-only home. Because they were scared, they were living in fear. Things started to shift in their their thoughts and what was happening in the world. And then they started to understand and talk to me more about what their experiences were, and I was getting a little bit older and so on and so forth. But knowing that at that moment, you know, at middle school, for example, that I had yet to have a relationship with my grandparents because they only spoke Spanish. So we were, you know, the story was just like, just cut out for me. I didn't get to get it. I didn't get to know what their story was, and I didn't know Spanish. So then it was like, what the hell's going on? As I started to be more conscious, like, my grandmothers are getting old, I don't know their story, I had to teach myself Spanish. I mean, all of those things really influenced why my grandmothers, I did not know their story. I learned later that their story was erased by their husbands or by their community. They weren't allowed to drive, they weren't allowed to write, they weren't allowed to leave the house. Or my grandfathers were going out dancing and doing their thing, and going drinking and doing their thing. And all those moments of consciousness for me made me go like, this is messed up. These women don't have a story. They do, I mean, they do have a story, but for me it was like, what is it? So I went on a constant discovery of like, spent all this time with my grandmothers before they passed. All this time, I mean, slept with them in their bed, you know, whenever they were over, I'm like, wanted to be there all the time. And then when I realized that my story as a queer woman, I couldn't tell anyone. I started to feel the, like I was more empathetic, or I understood what was going on. I had no one to tell. My parents were very Catholic, very traditional. And so I was able to see through their eyes in a way of not being able to tell my story, feeling completely alone, feeling isolated, not having a language. And then my language went into the stories that I wrote and the artwork that I created. That became a survival piece for me. So it saved my life. From moments of attempted suicide, from moments of feeling like I didn't want to belong, I didn't want to be there, and that art saved me in that way, because I had somewhere to put that story. A little bit later on in my life, when I went to grad school, I remember in Vermont, we were in a circle, it was the first group of, it was for creative writing, for MFA, and we were sitting around the circle and I was like, why are you writing? It was all, my whole class were white people, right? And there was like one black woman in the program, myself, and a woman from Spain in the program. That's it, the whole MFA program in Vermont. So in my circle of eight, everyone was like, oh, I want to be a writer because I've been studying, you know, the New York Times bestsellers, and I've been studying the trends and sentence lines. They wanted to like turn it into a business. Then they got to me and I was like, I have to write because nobody knows the stories of my grandmothers, let's be real here, and all of our grandmothers, and our ancestors, and the people, the thousands of people that have walked before us. And that's why, for me, I also know now that art is what tells us our story. The art of the Aztecs, the building of the Aztecs, the math, the science, the astrology attached to that art, it's all connected. And so that drives me every day. And my career path has been, I went to undergrad, became an English major, was an English teacher, then an art teacher, art administrator, and that gave me an opportunity to say, okay, I'm gonna leave education and try to do art as much as I can full time and figure out other ways to balance. I am a realtor, which is random, but I thought I would just because it's given me an opportunity to work with artists, to help artists find homes in San Antonio, or they're kicked out by huge condos, and also to feed my kids and work and schedule and compartmentalize my life that way so I can be an artist.
Good answer, I know. Okay, I guess I'll start with my career path right now. I'm an adjunct professor at Our Lady of the Lake University. Thanks y'all for being here. Right now I'm also a gallery coordinator at the Movement Gallery, part of Southwest Workers Union, so trying to get more involved with like art and activism ties, and also co-publish the feminist scene, Yes Ma'am, and we do things, you know, just like all kind of, any kind of art things that come up, I guess. I think we all kind of go out of our normal bounds of like what our career bubble is a lot. There's been tons of, you know, microaggressions along the way. That's a part of the journey. And I guess a big thing for me was in grad school, like not feeling or feeling like political art that I wanted to make was kind of shunned. Or it wasn't conceptual enough, I got the word didactic thrown at me like all the time. That's a big one of those. And I would like joke like, well, someday I'm gonna start like the didactic school of art, and you know, like, so those kind of will, you know, critique you, and a lot of the time, like as a woman of color, your art is a lot about your identity, and so it feels like they're not just critiquing your work, but they're critiquing like who you are. And so I think those kind of critiques that I would get made me just that much more sure of like, this is what I'm doing. Like I'll take what you're saying like with a grain of salt, and then I'll say, okay, I know that maybe this is, I'm doing something that like I need to stick with, and you know, kind of defend yourself, defend your didacticism or whatever, you know, someone might be, you know, telling you that is wrong or is not, you know, elite or whatever, you know, that art world hierarchy kind of thing. And so it's good to be back in San Anto because I feel just the cultures, there's like this embracing of culture and in ways that, you know, the word elite, like art institutions are not really grasping still, and which is unfortunate because you want them to be this kind of, you know, radical place, but they're just not there. They fit into these constructs of, you know, capitalism and everything. But anyway, that's me rambling. So yeah, I think there is this kind of pressure for a lot of artists, like, oh, you have to move to New York City, be a starving artist, and like try and fit in and like do all this stuff. But there's so many different art worlds that are there. You know, we have it in Texas, we have it in San Anto, we have it in this row of artists, and I think like we're needed in Texas. And it's like that idea of like, you know, maybe this is a conservative state, but that's why we need to be here and try to, you know, make change and just like leave. And so that's the whole thing with that. Another thing I guess I wanted to mention, because I think this is the time for bringing up these like tools to talk about ideas, is it, within even the Chicano arts and Chicano art collectors, there is a very scarce representation of women of color, Latinas, Chicanas, and that is a big issue and something that I think we need to be talking about for sure. Even like within our own circles, how are we still being, you know, not being represented? And so I guess that's my spiel for now.
Everyone, the energy in this room is such that if I begin to levitate, you'll know why. Everything that I've been hearing is it is my life as well. I'm an Air Force brat. I was very, very lucky to have parents who, because of the military, in a strange kind of way, kind of hid the culture from me. My parents always spoke English around me because they didn't want me to have a Mexican accent. I live on the south side, I live in the house that I grew up in. And during the 60s, I saw the world very differently. I saw it through the lens of militarism, if you will. And to counter that, I was lucky enough to have a dad who was a medical illustrator, who had the most incredible ability to take a pencil and just start drawing. He could sketch you in a matter of minutes and it would look just like you. And I was so intimidated by that. And at a very early age, my parents realized that our son is not like how we thought he would be. And for Christmas 1968, I told my parents I wanted a Barbie doll for Christmas. And they gave me a camera. And it was just one of many, many things that my parents were giving me to take, to get me out of that phase. And I've known everything that every woman in this room knows, every female. I'm not female, but I am a woman. Every woman in here knows, and I share that common knowledge because guess what? I live in a world where men would look at anyone in a skirt or wearing makeup, perhaps, and think that they were a prize to be had. And because of that, I had a very, very strong mother and my grandmother. My grandmother didn't speak English, and so here's the weird part, because as a child growing up, I only heard Spanish spoken in my grandparents' house, but whenever I walked in the room, they would immediately they would start speaking English. Of course, my grandmother would just sit there and smile. And that is, you know, those things were formative in my life at a very early age. And I knew I was a girl when I was like 4 years old. I also knew that I wanted to express the world that I was seeing, and I didn't know how. And I would look at my dad's, every time we'd go, my dad was at Brooks Air Force Base in the medical illustration department. He had a huge, gigantic table, and it was full of all sorts of art things, and drawings, and paintings, and so many things. And I would look at his work, and I would just be so intimidated by them. I would think to myself, you know, I'd look at my little crayon drawings of stick men and women, and stick dogs and cats, and think, oh my gosh, you know, it's just not happening. And you know, when I got that camera, it literally changed my life. It was the key. It became the means for me to show people what I'm thinking about, things that I think are important, the things that I want to say, and I do so with the camera. And because of the two ways that I've seen life, I found out at a very early age that I'm a woman. I've known that my entire life, and it has influenced all of my work, and all of my friends, and all of my family are all about women. And the images behind me of the International Women's Day March, I've been to pretty much every single one since I came home in 2000. I came home in 2000 because my mom at the time was 82 years old, and I'm an only child, and my dad had passed away years before. And so when my dad died, I was like, I'm not going to let my mom die on her own. She's not going to die by herself. And so I came home because she fell in the winter of 1999, and no child ever wanted gets the call, you know, where your parent is like, I'm okay. And you know, when I heard that, it was time for me to come home, and I submitted my letter of resignation at the Braswell Herald, where I had been a staff photographer for 15 years. And I came home and I worked for the Express and News, and I went back to school again at SAC for like the second time. Okay, right on, okay. And I was very, very fortunate to have professors. My photo J professor was graduated from the University of Missouri at Columbia, renowned for photojournalism in the U.S. and indeed around the world as well. So I had photography instructors. Oh my gosh, she's not here right now. She were brain lock. I'm so old. My brain just doesn't squeaking. Anyhow, every influential person in my life that's ever helped me has been a woman, and. You know, we're all sisters. We are all sisters, and even the men in the room, we're all sentient beings on this planet. We're sentient beings, and we're cruising on this big rock, and hopefully we're communicating with one another, that's really the best way to live, because if you're afraid of your neighbor, if you're afraid of the other, then it's just going to be not good. You know, there's no harmony, there's no love, and really that's what this is all about, making pictures when I'm in the studio, when I'm in the dark room, and by the way, emerging, you said you just got your studio. So Kim, I just got my studio last month, and it's at Sean, at his dad's place, Lone Star Art Space, and I'm so lucky to be there, and it's incredible. And I've moved my darkroom, my enlarger that I bought when I was 15 from my first summer job. I saved up all my little money, and I bought an enlarger downtown at Southwest Camera, which has since long gone out of business, along with, what was it, the light. I was very, very lucky. My parents read to me, my grandparents read to me, and my grandfather, not my grandmother, but my grandfather would read the light to me every day. And, you know, being read to and not being, you know, talked down to as late on a child, just being spoken to in the way, you know, the way we do. Oh my gosh, that really develops a child's brain, and the thirst for knowledge becomes such that, why do we create art? Why do we live? Because we have to, because it's in us and we can't stop doing it, or it's like not breathing.
You came from this super conservative, super religious family, and for me, art is sort of like my church, and not in the sense that I worship it, but it's where I go to think about the world and my place in it and ask all these questions that that I was always told not to ask. That I heard that so many times as a child. Just, you ask so many questions, stop! and also a super assimilationist family where I would not tell Spanish, and I went to Mexico all the time to visit my relatives who I was not even taught to communicate with, which is sort of insane, but it's interesting that there are so many of those stories. So I make art because it's the way that I understand the world, and I am a lifelong student. I love learning, and this is a way that I do it, and some of my art is research-based. And it's a way to engage in dialogue. So you're communicating through the work, and then when you put the work out in the world, hopefully people want to talk to you about it, and then you start conversations that are really interesting and maybe even life-changing, and that's something I think is really important and kind of magical. So for my career, Kim and Anel, I'm a mother, and I have a 6-year-old and a 2-year-old, so I'm really, really in the thick of it. My day job is I'm an exhibitions assistant at the Southwest School of Art, and also a preparator. I do a little bit of teaching. What that means is I do, in their exhibitions department, I do some admin work, but I also install exhibitions, pack and unpack all of the work, edit videos. I sort of have a really broad skill set that I get to bring to it. But being a preparator, it's a super male-dominated field. Mostly people come to that work because they have had some experience in carpentry, because you have to do a lot of wall repair and building things, and that's something that, you know, like, they learned it from their uncle, or they learned it from their older friend, and it's harder for women to have someone in their life that's gonna guide them into that skill. So I've learned a lot, and I actually got into it with my digital skills, because nobody could set up a new media installation. And so as a new media artist, I kind of got my foot in the door, and then now I've learned how to do all these other kinds of skills. In school, I worked sort of every kind of job that you can imagine to get myself through school. And since I got out of graduate school, I was an adjunct professor for about 6 years. I taught at UPenn, I taught at Palo Alto, I taught at St. Philip's, I taught at UTSA, and I loved being an educator, but after 6 years, I realized how very exploitative adjunct work can be. sorry. But I know that a lot of you are students, and I just want to throw this out to you that almost 75% of your professors are part-timers. That may not even come to mind for you, but they're part-timers, they receive no benefits, they are paid very, very little, and especially in San Antonio, they're paid very little. So after I had a child, I could not hack it. I couldn't do that and pay for daycare and be a working person. So then I coordinated a teen program, an after-school art program for a while. I've also done independent, like freelance design gigs for extra money. I was a math tutor. I taught people how to do math for the GRE, which is a test to go into graduate school, which shocks everyone because nobody thinks that artists can do math, but they can, and you need math to build stuff. You really need math. And also have been a community arts educator, and I still do some teaching at the Southwest School.
Thank you so much for sharing these experiences with us. I think what I would like for you all to share is, can you tell us here, what are some ways in which you navigate artistic spaces or non-artistic spaces as an artist here? Something that our students in the audience can walk away with. Does anyone want to start? So what are some ways in which you navigate these artistic spaces or non-artistic spaces? I know some of you have mentioned a few, but does anyone want to bring anything else up?
Is it okay if I grab the mic again? Okay. One, I think addressing what Susy was talking about, that there are many different art worlds, recognizing that, and also recognizing that not every single person in the world is in your audience, and that's okay, you know? You may be speaking to a particular segment of the population, which can be diverse in its own way, but if not everyone in the world is touched by your work, it's okay. It doesn't mean there's something wrong with it, and it just means it's a little more specific. And asking for help, forming your own mafia, which is something that one of my mentor professors would tell us all the time. And I think really what that means is cultivating community, helping each other rather than thinking of your art community as this dog-eat-dog kind of world. You're helping to lift everybody up at the same time, and you put that energy out there, and then later somebody's gonna help you. I think being politically engaged in your art or otherwise. So my piece over there is more overtly political than most of my work is. It's usually, there's some kind of feminist or political thread going under it, but it's more conceptual. The problems that are common to artists and women artists, we may feel in a different way, but they're common to everyone. And so things like arts funding, right? We're sitting in the city building for arts. We have a mayoral election coming up, right? Like, as artists, we need to think about that kind of stuff. We need to participate because it's affecting our daily lives, and education that affects our daily lives. Health insurance, having a family, you know, and family services and family leave aren't just for people who have children, you know, it's for people who are caring for parents. I think recognizing that whatever kind of art you're making, you're part of your art community, and being kind of a good citizen in your art community, but also being a good citizen in the community at large.
Yeah, I definitely want to, you know, piggyback on that. One thing that I think is important is that, you know, having community is very important. Gathering community is very important. Being that person that gathers community is very, very important, because as artists, as women, as people, as, you know, just making it through this world, we have to gather. We have to also simply meditate, take time for yourself, keep your body healthy, because it is a lot of work to be an artist. And with that, remind people that it is work. A lot of times you're like, oh, you're at home making art, how cute. You're like, that's not cute. It was hard. I mean, it's work. It's physical work. It hurts your body, it hurts your neck, it hurts your back, your legs. The hours, the no sleeping, you're laying down, all you have is ideas. There's a lot of work. So part of, you know, being an artist and getting and maneuvering through space is also knowing that it is a job, taking it seriously. And I say the word job, and I try not to use it when people go, oh, what are you gonna do? I'm like, I have to work. I hate saying that, but sometimes it's the only thing people get. Because when they hear work, they're like, oh, you gotta work. But if you say, oh, I'm gonna ride, they're like, oh, that's so cute, have fun. Coffee, and you ride, I'm like, oh my God. But so I say, I'm gonna work. And then I say, I ride, I wake up at 5:30, I ride in the morning. Give yourself discipline to do that work. Part of navigating, for me, surviving the world as an artist is having a group of critical friends. So there's like, number one, I have a group of critical friends, and they might not live here. You know, one of my critical friends lives in New Mexico, one of them lives in Berkeley, and the others are here in San Antonio. But when I have a piece that I'm writing or drawing or talking about, I'm like, oh, is this gonna offend? What am I doing? This is what I really wanna do? Is it doing it right? And I'll call those critical friends. I'll send it to them, give them a couple days. Don't expect them to turn something around for you in a minute. Give people time and trade. Be their critical friend also. They have work they need to be looked at, and look at their work also. So there's that critical friend, and then there's the cheerleader friends. You also want the friends that are like, oh my God, it's so beautiful, I love it, I love you, you're awesome. You know, navigating in those spaces. You need cheerleader friends, right? Because sometimes you're like, nobody likes my work, I haven't had a show, nobody called me. And then you just call your cheerleader friend. They're like, oh my God, your work's amazing. I'm looking at it right now, it's on my desk. You know, they give you this beautiful, you do that. Sometimes you just do. Maybe it's your mom, maybe it's your grandma. You know, maybe it's your dog. My dogs are my, sometimes I'm there in the office by myself, and I'm like, well, what do you think? You know, they make me. But you gotta do, there's a lot of little things. So gathering, critical friends, cheerleader friends, and being vocal, taking your work seriously, reading and doing research, knowing the numbers that 23% of the San Antonio Museum of Art,
the permanent collection
is women, being able to
Latina.
See that. Latina.
There are women and, yes, sir.
Yeah, only how many were Latinas?
Three.
So it's like, say that to people. No, we need to do this. This is serious. Ask people for money. Artists need to be paid. Don't expect, they need to eat. All of the young students here. You want to do free things for community and so on and so forth, but they have money to pay people from all over the world. They have money to pay you. So demand that also, please.
I realized that maybe I didn't fully answer the last question of why I do what I do, I guess. I definitely feel obligated to make work like as an agent of social change, and I know that's not everyone, but I think that like we have so many issues today that we're facing that, you know, people who are given this gift of creativity, like we have so much power, and that like this is an outlet to use that, and you can, you know, use art as activism. You know, art is culture. Art creates culture, and even like teaching modern art right now, I'm seeing all, you know, it's Eurocentric, it's male dominated, and how can we like make our own place in that, you know, for ourselves and for our sisters and everyone, using that power we have to critique the world around us. Like, we can't just stand by and make a pretty picture anymore. I think it's not progressive. So, you know, if we want to be progressive, I think we need to tackle big ideas. You know, this is our time to do that.
something that I wrote down, which was like my first instinct of how navigating the art world, is that I'm definitely guilty and more inclined to apply to things when I see that the jurors or hiring team are women or women of color, because I know that like I have a better chance, and that is just like a harsh reality. And I think it's an issue of representation for both us, the artist, the applicant, and you know the hiring team. You know how you know they've had their own struggles getting to where they are. It would be an ideal world if I didn't feel like I had to do that, right? But you know the fact is it's not, and I think that's what makes spaces like this all that more important, that we are able to come together, you know, make our own spaces. And so that's I guess my first instinct there.
What Susy said about space, I would really like to shout out to the Esperanza Peace and Justice Center, to Graciela Sanchez, to Claudia Ramirez, to one of my, besides Mary Agnes, that somebody mentioned over here, one of my inspiring artists for me is Veronica Castro. She works in clay. She fires her clay, she details her work. Her adobos de vida are incredible works of art that sell for many thousands of dollars. And she just opened her studio on South Flores, and it's basically about, I could probably walk from my house to her house. And that's something really cool, because I was leaving Lone Star Art Space the other night, and it was late at night. I'd been in the dark room printing all night, and I thought, this is incredible that I only live 2 miles from my gallery. And, you know, I'm just now, at 58, I'm just now emerging into the art world. I have no art background. I have no art degree. I was a journalism major, and don't ask me to write, because cut lines are just even that much for me. But having, and the funny thing is, you know, I've been published around the world and across the country, in magazines and newspapers, in various languages, and that's the beauty of a visual image, is that it does not need an interpreter. One simply has to look at the work to feel something, and hopefully as an artist you'll be able to make people feel, and you don't really need to have one particular group of people. Or when I photograph, I'm just thinking of images, and they're open to all, and I think that's something as artists, I think all of us want to reach as many people as possible. We want everyone to see what we have to say, and hopefully they'll be able to feel something. They'll have. You can evoke a response from someone after they look at your work. You know you did it. So, but anyhow, navigating in the world that I'm just now coming into, I'm surrounded by people who, in contemporary art, I've just finished. And every time the gallery was open, I was surrounded by people that had MFAs and BFAs, and were talking about works and their projects and their work, and the way they described their work, and the conversation between artists. You know, that language, wow, I am a child learning to speak that language. And, as a news photographer, just seeing the world around me and taking pictures of it and having it published, I mean, that was all I ever thought about, and I never assigned spectacular words to the work or anything like that. I'm a very, very simple girl. I'm from the South Side, and you know, I'm just lucky to have been, you know, the nurture and the nature of my being is such that, I'm lucky, that everything just worked out. I had parents that cared, I had teachers that cared. I wanted it. You have to want it, because if you don't want it, then everything in front of you is just going to be there, and it's not going to, you're not going to use it, you're not going to benefit from it, you're not going to grow from it. And that is something that, as any sentient being would want, is to grow and to live and to be in the world and at its maximum, to enjoy the world around us. And, you know, those are my thoughts. So.
I've taught art history for 23 years, and I really had no idea what I was getting into. When I first got that job, I just had my survey class in college, and they said, oh, and by the way, you're going to teach AP art history, and here's your textbook. So I've had to do a lot of studying on my own, and one thing that I really realized is that art is the documentation of our existence. And if we don't document our history, nobody else is going to do it for us. We have something to say. We have stories. And those need to be told. And that's why I make art. That is why I navigate the art community. And I'm so lucky here in San Antonio. I've been here 12 years, and this is my home, because of the supportive art community here that has allowed me to fumble around and find my place, you know? But my suggestion to students is do your research. Study. It's not a hobby. It's not a hobby unless you want it to be a hobby, and then that's fine. But for people who are artists, it's not a hobby. Do take it seriously. Do take it seriously within your community. Have a conversation. Say what's on your mind. And be flexible enough to listen to other people's minds as well. And take what you can from it.
Now, I know it's you. We have one more question for the panel. Can we go that route? Okay.
Y'all are fine.
If y'all are fine with that, we do have a window for Q and some questions. So just real quick then, if everyone's okay with that. So the last question that we have for the panel, we wanted folks to share. If anyone needs to leave, please do so. I really appreciate y'all being here. Please pick up, there's a handout, a list of resources that we put together for artists, so please be sure to pick it up, and if not, then we can send you an email with it too. So just real quick here, one of the questions that we had for our panelists was, and real quick, please just answer maybe like a word or two. Do you have any advice or shout out to give the audience about your methods of professional development as an artist?
Go. Okay, well, the what I said before about community and helping other people, and they will help you, and don't be afraid to ask for help. One thing that has helped me a lot that I don't think people realize is if you're applying for a school or a grant or a show, ask your critical friend to help you look it over and give you suggestions. And then, you know, you'll help them next time. And also look at, do I know any artists who got this grant before me? And if I do, can I just talk to them? Can I ask them, hey, I know that you got this award. Will you look at my proposal? And most of the time, they'll say yes. And that is incredibly helpful.
I want to second that and definitely ask for help. And I guess to add to it, you know, there's so many artists. I know that all of us are here at this table, but we don't all work together necessarily, like one and one all the time. We're not always working together. We all have our art communities. So that's connected to knowing that there are many art communities and we're all doing work, but we can all love each other and we can all support each other. And we know everyone's doing their work. If I don't go to Sara's show, and this has a point, I promise. If I don't get to go to Sara's opening, if I don't get to go to your opening, it's not because I don't want to go, it's because I might have an opening or I might have an event. So the moral to my message is ego. Kind of let that go, your ego. We are not the only artists individually in the world. Everybody is doing their work. And just be happy that there are so many artists doing so many things. And everyone's working together with the same purpose, to create art, to document our stories, to write our history, so on and so forth. And sometimes let that go, you know? We all want to help each other. Ask for help. We all want to be there for each other, everyone. If I am having a low time, I can say, Kim, do you know of some shows? Kim will call me back, even though we talk twice a year, you know? I mean, but she will, you know, that's the way it'll be. And hopefully we can build community that way and keep it like that. So that's what I have to say.
First thing I think is just apply to everything that ever is there. you're gonna get rejected from a lot of things, and don't let that get you down. I realize that like the places that are right for you are the ones that accept you. You know, if they want you, you should want them. It should be this like this mutual, you know, love, right? And like wanting of each other. Another that was kind of touched on is like if you meet someone at an opening or online, or you see people you admire. Become their friend. Say like, hey, let's get lunch. And that is like a networking thing and a friendship building thing. And you know, like meet your idols and then like give yourself the respect to say like, I'm amongst them. You know, like I'm not like, don't just call yourself a student, call yourself an artist, you know? And say like, hey, I'm an artist, so are you. You know, we're the same, you know? Like, not like try to avoid that hierarchy, I guess. And give yourself credit for what you do. Because yeah, no one's gonna you know make those things happen for you but yourself. So.
What Susy said, what it now said about your ego. Oh my gosh. Yeah. You know, you may think you're great. You may show your work, and it's so important that you show your work as much as possible. Show it to everybody who will take the time to look at it and ask them to take the time. And if they don't like it, don't stop. But at the same time, don't get such a big head and you're like, hey, what's wrong with you? Why don't you like my work? You know, don't do that. You know, just take it and move on and continue to work. Learn. Use your brain. Let your brain soak in information, develop your mind, do whatever it takes to become a better human, to become someone who will make this a better world, not just for those of us that are here now, but for the future line that hopefully will stretch into infinity. I mean, how long will we stay on this planet? But that's really what we're working for is we're not working for ourselves, we're working for everyone who's coming after us. So, okay, I'll stop.
Life is this long, and we are so honored to have been given this opportunity. Don't take it for granted. Don't ever take it for granted. Use every minute of it to the best that you can, even if it's just by yourself. And respect yourself, even when other people may not, and you feel like other people don't respect you. You are your own best friend. And if you don't respect and value what you do, nobody else will either. So go through life respecting yourself, respect those around you, listen, be flexible, speak meaningfully, know what you're talking about, and enjoy every second.